Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning, Tejeshwar.
Greetings from College Duniya. I would like to inform our viewers that Kritika is the alumnus of National Law University, Delhi. She is practicing advocate in Delhi High Court and Supreme Court. She is also one of the founding members of Vijay Bhumi University. And we are truly delighted to have her on our leadership series, Thoughtful Leaders. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Tejeshwar, for having me. I think it's truly an honor to be invited on College Duniya's platform. I mean, you guys are doing great work, so keep it up.
Thank you, ma'am. So, ma'am, as the board director of Vijay Bhumi University, can you throw some light on its genesis? What was the idea behind the establishment of this institute, university?
Right. So, you know, the first and foremost thing I think that we felt was that India was, you know, we have a booming youth population. But unfortunately, in terms of the quality of educational institutions that we have, we really are not, you know, finding any mention of our Indian institutions in, you know, when you talk about global rankings. So we actually wanted to bring an institution to India which would be at par in terms of the curriculum, at par in terms of the choices that we offer to the students, and at par in terms of pedagogy to, you know, the some of the top ranked institutions worldwide. The other thing that we realized, and you know, my father always recounts this, is that, you know, he felt that, you know, the education system in India was only breeding followers and workers. So what was missing was that we were not able to create aspiration in, you know, children and students. We were not, you know, providing them a platform in terms of educational institutions to discover themselves and their inner passions. I mean, most of, you know, I'm talking about my generation here today. I mean, you know, we've had no sort of influence in our life that has actually helped us realize what we must really do, right? What our inner calling is. You know, somewhere in India, your inner calling, what your passion is always in the back burner. What's in the front is, you know, what everybody else is doing, what is the peer pressure, what are the upcoming streams according to others. And that's, you generally, there's this herd mentality and you follow that without, you know, looking into yourself that, you know, what am I cut out to be? So we wanted to provide an educational institution where children come and discover themselves and they're able to understand and realize for themselves that what is their potential, what is their inner calling, what is their dream career. So our entire curriculum at Vijay Bhumi University is structured in a way to give children the platform to discover, to, you know, experiment with various streams and understand for themselves that, you know, what is it that their inner calling is. So in a nutshell, this was the problem that we were trying to solve through Vijay Bhumi University.
That's really a novel thought, ma'am. So ma'am, you have been in various leadership positions. What is your philosophy on leadership and how would you describe your leadership style?
So I think that, you know, an ideal leader is one who helps people grow under, you know, themselves. Like, you know, it's not somebody who believes that, okay, fine, if I am the leader, I only need to put myself out there in the front. No, I think especially when you talk about the education space, the space I'm coming from, it's more of a collaborative and a team effort. We are nothing without the team that is backing us. We are nothing without our faculty. They play the more important role. So it's very important to take everybody together and to keep everybody on an equal footing. So I think that is the sort of style that, you know, I adopt, you know, personally. And I think that is what is required in the education space because, like I said, you know, it is too much of a team and collaborative effort. We are all working with one purpose, which is to make the life of the student better, to ensure they have continuous learning. We are making them continuously employable and prepared for the future. So I think when we all have a common goal, we all work as one towards it. So there's no hierarchy as such. Everybody's you know, ideas are given enough weight and we discuss and brainstorm everything.
Rightly said, ma'am. Ma'am, you spoke about the curriculum earlier. So how is the curriculum being changed so that it is in synchronization with the market trends?
So I think more than the market trends, I mean, the topic that everybody is talking about today is the new education policy of 2020, right? And if you especially see the kind of changes that the new education policy 2020 is bringing in the higher educational space, we are definitely leaning towards more of a liberalized curriculum, right? So even if you see at a school level, from 8th standard, they are wanting to give students, you know, the power of choice to choose what do you want to study. Right. And the main reason, and I think that's a brilliant move. And I think that the main reason why they've done that is that, you know, we've come to realize as a society that imposing subjects on students which they may not be interested in is going to take away the appetite of learning within students, and that's where learning stops for students. I mean, it's important for you to, you know, help them study what they enjoy studying and let them pursue that. So, you know, if I were to talk about that at Vijayabhumi, that's the same thing that we are bringing in. I mean, we are following the liberal framework. Yes, we are offering professional programs, but even in the professional programs, the curriculum architecture that we have, our first year is something called the discovery year. So in the discovery year, a student at Vijayabhumi University, they might be a declared, you know, law graduate, or they might be a declared BBA, you know, like they wanting to be a BBA graduate, etc. But first year, you know, we tell them that when you come, we offer them foundational courses from 8 different streams, right? And this is what the liberal framework is about, that you give them exposure to the various different streams and then let them decide for themselves that what is it that they want to pursue their majors and minors in. So I think that in a way is, you know, something that, you know, Vijayabhumi University is very much aligned with the new education policy, which is, you know, emphasizing such a great thrust on liberalizing curriculums today. So that is definitely one thing. And I think the way our curriculum is modeled, it really prepares students for the fourth industrial revolution. I mean, we like it or not today, especially with this pandemic, we have all realized that, you know, technology is going to be a part of each and every profession. So technology, studying technology, understanding technology, how to use technology, is something that students cannot run away from. They can choose, they can be a lawyer, they can be a doctor, they can be anything, but you need to understand technology. And I think we have done a decent job of integrating technology in all our curriculums. And that's what ensures that we are preparing a student who's actually prepared to take on the fourth industrial revolution, where we are talking about the complete automation and digitization of all sectors of industries.
That's really great to know, ma'am. Ma'am, amidst this lockdown, what are your plans for the upcoming batch in terms of induction and classes?
Right. So, amidst this lockdown, so I don't know how many of you already know this, but Vijayabhumi University is backed by the same institutions, by the same group that backs IFM institutions in Bangalore that has a 25-year-old legacy. So I think, you know, the best example I can give is of IFM. I think, you know, the fact that, you know, we have a good digital infrastructure, and, you know, as a university and as an institution, we had that foresight that it's important to invest in now technology. We were able to ensure that we had unhindered classes. Our academic calendars have not been affected at all, right from wellness to our mentorship program, to our research initiatives, to our classes, to our online examinations. Everything has happened as per schedule. Now, if you talk about the incoming batches, our orientation schedules are ready. We have already lined up a great and fascinating set of, you know, orientation speakers who will be part of Orientation Week. We would love to physically welcome our students on campus, but that is something that depends on the situation. But having said that, we are not going to change anything in our calendar. We have already set a date. We are going to start either virtually or physically as per that, and everything will go as per the academic calendar. I mean, as an institution, I think we take a lot of pride in the fact that, you know, we have been able to adapt very quickly to this digital revolution that the education space has been, you know, forced to go through because of coronavirus.
That's really great to know, ma'am. Ma'am, with the competition so high, how do you guide your students to survive in this competitive scenario?
I think, Tejeshwar, that's a very good question. And I think, you know, about surviving competition, see, the day you find what you love and you're doing what you love, the competition's not going to matter. Right? Because if I am, you know, doing my, you know, I'm, if, you know, I land up with my dream job, or I'm, you know, in, I'm, you know, in the dream profession of mine, what others do will become immaterial, because it is your drive and passion for that, you know, goal that you have set for yourself, and for that inner calling and that love that you have towards that profession that will drive you. So all of the other things around you will become immaterial. And I think this is so important also for you to discover that if you talk about from a mental health aspect. A lot of people in India, unfortunately, ignore the mental health aspect. But I seriously believe that, you know, if you're doing something that you absolutely, you know, love, that also improves your mental well-being. Because you're obviously, you don't feel that your work is burden. When your work becomes, you know, you see it as a burden or it becomes stressful, is when, you know, you're obviously a little more prone to, you know, mental health issues. Because you see it as, you know, some sort of a baggage on you mentally. But, you know, if you're doing something that you love, you're constantly going to be inspired every day to, you know, be better at it and, you know, achieve more and more targets within whatever you're doing. So I think that is the biggest difference, that, you know, we tell them focus on first discovering yourself. You first realize what is your inner purpose. And these are not things that I'm just saying, you know, I mean, we have a very structured program to it. Because when students come to us, you know, at IFM or be it Vijayabhoomi, the first exercise that we give them is we actually assign a mentor to them and we help them discover that what is their statement of purpose. And once students, you know, are able to achieve their statement of purpose, they suddenly realize how everything is aligning to it and they see that clarity in their life, right? So, I mean, these are, you know, certain interventions that I think education institutions really need to do. I mean, we need to realize that our job is not just, you know, going into class, delivering a lecture and coming out. It's a lot more than that. It's about the holistic development of a child. You know, children come to us when they're 18. You know, that's a pretty tender age. We have to hold their hand and guide them in the process of, you know, actually discovering themselves. Because everybody does not get the benefit of that environment at home. So, I mean, as an educational institution, you do carry that onus on you.
Rightly said, ma'am. Holistic development is very essential. Ma'am, because of this COVID, people are very much skeptical about the final placements. So, what are your thoughts on this skepticism?
So, again, I mean, I know obviously the economy is not doing that well. The job markets are not looking that great. But my biggest thing to that is, I think as educational institutions, our duty at this point of time is actually to create professionals that are absolutely adept to these times, right? The changing times. So, you know, if you're going to create again a run-of-the-mill professional, there is going to be no job for them. But now, for example, with coronavirus, what has it led to? It's led to the boom of digital businesses, right? So we need more professionals who are absolutely adept in digital skills. Now, if you're going to make that a part of your curriculum and your students who are, you know, graduating from your institutions are people who are able to perform very well in these roles of digital businesses, they're easily going to be absorbed in these forms. So it's really about how you are training them. The same run-of-the-mill approach is not going to work. We have to understand what are the needs of the industry at this point of time. What are the businesses that are doing well? Because obviously COVID has given that sense of realization to everybody that digitization is the way forward. So you have to ensure that the future student population that you're going to be giving into the workforce, they are people who can find themselves, you know, jobs in those roles. So your curriculum also has to be tuned according to that. So there is this need for, you know, a close working between industry as well as academia. And this is something that we do very successfully at both IFM and Vijayabhoomi, because we constantly make sure that be it teaching, be it our mentorship, be it our, you know, increased emphasis on internships, we are constantly interacting with the professional world and we are very much making them a part of the student's life. And we are also ensure that we're drawing enough from them in terms of constantly evolving our curriculum.
That's really great to know, ma'am. Ma'am, what are the future plans of the university in terms of number of campuses or courses? Will there be any expansion plan?
Right. So as of now, we are starting off with 5 schools at Vijayabhoomi University. But definitely, we do have plans to, you know, expand further. We would want to make it like within the next 2-3 more years, we would want to introduce more streams. We would want to make it from a 5-school university to, you know, at least a minimum of 10 schools universities, because like I said, we are a liberal professional university. So we want to keep working on increasing the diversity of the streams that the students are getting exposed to. So we are looking at starting, you know, a school on hospitality. We are looking at starting on, you know, more new age technology courses. So all of that is in the pipeline. So as of now, we are starting off with a law school. We have a business school. We have a design school and we have a school of data sciences and artificial intelligence. And obviously under this, you know, you will see year on year that we're going to be introducing more schools, we're going to be introducing more degrees under each of the schools. So that is definitely work in progress for us.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, what are your expectations from the students who are going to be the part of Vijay Bhumi family from this year onwards?
I think the biggest expectation for us, Tejeshwar, is that, you know, and I think, so again, a very important quality to have in these times is that they should be willing to adapt to change, right? Because the curriculum I'm talking about today, the kind of teaching methodology that we're going to have, where there's going to be a lot of co-teaching between working professionals and professors, the kind of, you know, real life projects that we have, because we don't have this philosophy that, you know, students can only learn in classrooms and, you know, theoretical teaching is the only way. We really believe that, you know, if you want to instill skills like social responsibility, or if you're today talking about holistic development, it's really important for you to, you know, structure interventions which actually inculcate these values in children by doing. So our emphasis more is on learning by doing. And this is something that a lot of students are not, unfortunately, exposed to at a school level, because there it's mostly, you know, cram learning, rote learning, and it's just a one-way street between the teacher and students. So what we expect is that students come with an open mind and they're willing to unlearn that methodology that, you know, they have been through in school, and they're willing to, you know, actually experience experiential learning where they learn by doing. Because our every single intervention, be it academic, our other curricular interventions, be it our social immersion program, our research incubation program, our personality enhancement program, everything is focused towards learning by doing, learning by practice. So we just want students to be adaptive, and I think from there we're good to go.
Rightly said, ma'am. Learn by doing. That's a very novel thought, actually. What would be your suggestion or message to the students who are aspiring to join your prestigious institute?
Like I said, I think, you know, to all the students who are wishing to come to Vijay Bhumi University, the only advice that I have is come with an open mind. And more importantly, to, you know, the larger student population out there, I think, you know, with coronavirus, you know, the outbreak that has happened, I think every student needs to pause. I need to think that why are they doing what they're doing? Why are they choosing a particular stream, you know, which they have chosen? Is it because they genuinely want to do it or because it's under peer pressure? Most importantly, it is also for them to first understand that, you know, this entire scenario that the world is going through right now, how is it going to change the world in the future? And what is going to be the need in the future? What kind of professionals the need, you know, the world will need? Once you have some sort of a vague idea of that in your mind, you will be able to understand that what are the valuable sort of courses that you should be a part of. And the other important thing is, please don't go by labels. I think, you know, I wish that, you know, during our time there was somebody who could guide us like this, but out of experience I'm saying this, just don't go by the name of a university. I think all, you know, this entire young generation that we have, we are equipped with, you know, we have such great access to information. We have everything available to us on our fingertips, on our mobile phone. When you are looking at a university, please make the effort of first understanding that what is the curriculum of the university? What are they going to teach you? What are the courses that you're going to learn? And then apply your mind to, you know, what is the world going to look like when you're going to graduate? So what you're learning, is that going to make you relevant then? That is the moot question that you need to answer. Once you answer that, you will be able to realize if this course is ideal for you and if this university is ideal for you. And once you have answered those questions, I think you will be more clear when you get enrolled in the university that why you are there. Right. That's my advice.
Rightly said, ma'am. Students should be aware why they are doing what they are doing. This discussion was really insightful. I hope our viewers will learn a lot from it. Thank you for your time, ma'am.
Thank you so much, Tejeshwar. Thank you so much, College Dunya, for giving us this platform. And to all our students who are watching this video, best of luck. I hope to see many of you at Vijay Bhumi.